Suicide continues to be a major public health issue in the U.S. The rate of people taking their own lives has increased 24% since 1999. That's according to the Center for Disease Control. In 2016, the CDC said the rate hit an all-time high. For young people between the ages of 15 to 34, it is the second leading cause of death. Why is the rate increasing? Why are so many young people feeling this is their only option? One family is still trying to figure that out when their son took his own life. They founded the Joshua York Legacy Foundation to help other families cope and hopefully prevent suicide. Joining me this morning to talk about the foundation and what they do and how you can get involved is founder and father of Joshua York, Bill York. Good morning, Bill. Welcome to Maryland Perspectives.
Thank you, Mary. I appreciate the opportunity.
Now, tell us about your son, Joshua, and how he inspired the creation of the foundation.
When he started his senior year of high school, he was struggling with being gay and trying to meet other people that were like him, that were not part of his school, so he wouldn't be alienated. He had a lot of friends in school, so a lot of good times, but still sort of felt isolated. At the beginning of his senior year, he actually was trying to meet people. He used a dating app, and on the first time that he met somebody, he was raped. You know, we did everything we could to get him to prosecute and pursue charges, but he didn't want the controversy in his senior year. He also had some body issues, so that eventually in his senior year he had a corrective chest surgery. So although he got the surgery and it corrected the most of that, he still had self-image issues. When he went off to college to James Madison University in Harrisonburg, he started having suicidal thoughts being away from family and his close-knit community in the first semester. Thankfully, he went out and got some help, submitted to the emergency care, and they contacted us. What we found, though, is being at a university with no vehicle because he was a freshman in a small town in Virginia, which had a very small LGBTQ community, that it was extremely difficult for us to find mental health care for him. We did eventually find it through a lot of work, but it took about a 22-minute Uber ride one way to get counseling. So you can imagine taking 15 credits and trying to fit in counseling and extracurricular activities just became a burden. So after the first semester, he gave up the counseling, but he got into some classes which actually had him speaking about it and helping other students. He was starting to be recognized on campus as someone that was open to the conversations about suicidal thoughts and sexual assault. So a lot of people sort of gravitated to him. As he entered his sophomore year, he switched to University of Maryland, College Park, where his partner that he had met the prior year had bought a house so that they could be closer to both work and school for them. And they were doing great. He had gotten his real estate license, settling on his first house in July 28, 2018, and just had a wonderful relationship. They traveled a lot. I had sold my boat, so they spent a lot of time on the bay. Even at our 4th of July party that last year, he told us how happy he was, that you know, had no regrets, that he appreciated us as parents, and that he had a happy childhood. And he was excited about closing on that house. And then just 3 weeks later, we got woke up in the middle of the night that he had taken his own life. And we feel, based on conversations we had after the fact, that something that day triggered his memory of the rape, because he had been talking about it during the day. I guess felt despair and hopelessness and made a very quick, poor decision in a moment that was irreversible.
This is so fresh, you know, this is only, a couple months ago. And as a family, can we talk about you for a second?
Sure.
How was your family able to cope with that and then start a foundation?
The day after we buried my son, I was sitting on the front porch and my wife came out and she said, you know, we got to do something. I feel like we got to do something. And I said, so what do you want to do, babe? She says, maybe a scholarship. So we started talking about scholarships. I'm a CPA by trade. So we had this conversation of, is it 1 year? Are we going to pay for it? Or is it going to end when we die? You know, all these kind of financial discussions. And ultimately, we got to the point where we wanted it to be perpetual in his memory, as a memorial. And, you know, I looked at her and said, well, if we're going to do that, we've got to create a foundation so that we can do it legally and not get in any trouble.
Right.
And so that's where the idea came from. as we progressed through those that first month, you know, it was extremely difficult. Josh has one older sibling from my first marriage and three younger siblings from my current marriage. So our younger siblings were shutting down, feeling angry, not feeling like they could talk. So my wife did some research and we started doing exercises, you know, dropping rocks in a vase and telling the positive stories and memories that we had of them, lighting candles and sharing our grief. One of those things we did was paint rocks. And honestly, I think that's been one of the more healing things with longevity for us. But of course, we also sought counseling. I myself went, my 13-year-old daughter has went. As we need it, we reach out and get the mental health care we need, because, you know, I don't know if you know the statistics, but 64 million Americans each year have some temporary or permanent mental health issue, and certainly losing a son caused depression in myself. So we took what we needed to do and tried to make something positive out of his life.
And so doing that, you did a lot of research, like you were saying. You've learned a lot about suicide, about you know, talking to professionals. So let's get into some of that. One of the things that you're trying to do with the foundation is education and talk about your story. Because once I'm sure you talked about your story, then other people can open up and talk about theirs. We're finding that that's helping out tremendously with just mental health across the board, just having a conversation. So let's talk about education. What were some of the things that you learned as a family when you were in your mourning for Josh?
The first thing we realized is that we had to continue talking. There's multiple stages of grief. It's not linear. So you can experience the grief, go to the next one, and go back to the first one,
right,
you know, endless amount of times. And, you know, I describe it as being on a river with it, and each of us in our own small raft tied together. And, you know, you're floating down the river, but nobody's at the exact same point at the exact same time. So you have to be very conscientious about how each other is feeling. As we struggle to, you know, make sense of things, to, you'll hear the term find the new normal, and I don't know if that's very accurate as a term, but it certainly is a process of trying to find a way forward. Like I said, we dropped rocks in a vase, we did memory candles, we really became sensitive to each other's emotions, and we still to this day try to communicate frequently. The big thing we do is suicide prevention rocks. And I don't know if you've ever heard of the Kindness Rock Project. We were down Ocean City at the Art League Ocean City 9 months before and did a free class on kindness rocks and painted them. And it was just so much fun that when this happened and we needed to get, you know, some positivity in our back into our lives, we sat down with the kids and painted some rocks. And then we went out in the White Marsh Perry Hall area and dropped them through the community. Before we did that, my wife said we ought to post them to our foundation Facebook page. So that night I put them up on the page, and within a week we had 250 people like the group Suicide Prevention Rocks. And it just grew and grew. Today we're over 12,300 people.
Wow.
Every single state in the U.S., 57 foreign countries, painting suicide prevention rocks and dropping them in their communities. But it just doesn't stop there, because the people who get on that group communicate with each other. It's you know, it's this group of people who've been affected, whether they've attempted themselves, lost somebody, know someone who's lost somebody. They come there and they paint positive messages to let people know that there's hope. And it spreads, continues to spread every single day. And what's magical about it to me is we have a rule out there, because we want to not have triggers. Keep it positive. So we have a rule that we call it the Purple Heart Rule. And with that rule, if somebody posts a Purple Heart, everybody else on that page knows that that person needs to talk. And normally within minutes, people start responding to them and offering their availability to communicate with them, to help them through whatever their moment they're having. It's really beautiful.
It is. What a great sense of community that's coming out of such despair. And I want to go back to Josh not being able to fit counseling or even find counseling when he needed it while he was in college. Mental health right now is a huge issue. There are a lot of people talking about having access to counselors, and it's a difficult task. What have you found when it comes to being able to access mental health care, and is your foundation working towards getting more information out about that?
That's a really excellent question, and it really highlights one of our major missions, which is to improve mental health accessibility. What we found is it takes weeks to get non-emergency adult mental health care. And if you need to get that for a child, it can take a year, even 2 years, because you know, we tried to get it for a six-year-old after our son passed, and they told us it would take up to a year to get him evaluated and up to another year to get him in for consistent counseling. It's just unacceptable. Furthermore, you know, HIPAA is, you know, the regulations are great for protecting our medical records and the abuse of that, but those same protections prevent parents like myself from understanding the depth of their child's diagnosis if the child doesn't want the parent to know, because once they turn 16, they have to have a HIPAA waiver to get access to those records. That's been very frustrating for us. In Maryland, we are extremely fortunate. There is a group called the Pro Bono Counseling Project, which we have connected with, and they offer free therapy to families, couples, and individuals throughout Maryland who have limited resources by providing access to volunteer licensed medical health professionals throughout the state and even other necessary services. And I'll put that out there. It's probonocounseling.org. They can be reached at 410-825-1001. We didn't know about them when we started down this journey, and you know, in the aftermath, we were struggling for the need of mental health care, and had we known they were out there, I think we would have made it through that process a bit quicker. So they're like Maryland's greatest unknown mental health secret, and I can tell you they've been out there about 20, 25 years.
Wow.
Maryland is one of the few states, if only state, that has a project like this. It should be, and we're hoping to, as we chapter out our foundation, we're hoping to work with that group to try to get other states to model Maryland's model, because it's the longest one and the most consistent one that survived throughout the United States.
You have a lot of aims with the foundation. You're spotlighting families with the program of the Angel Roll Call, which sounds a lot like some of your Kindness Rock project, where people are talking to each other. They're sharing their stories so that other families can share as well. And that's open to anybody. They can just go to your website and give you their story.
Yeah, so the Angel Roll Call, my son-in-law, my son's partner, we're looking for ways to help and expand what we have to offer. And, you know, what we've realized is so many people lose somebody in their family, and historically, it just wasn't acceptable to talk about it. I've met people who lost a sibling and weren't able to talk about it for 20 years. Mm. And so what we'd like to do is invite people who have lost someone to suicide to go out to our webpage, upload a photo, their birth date, their angel date, and a brief bio on them. We would like to, over time, collect as many of those bios and photos and eventually find a place that we can create a permanent memorial to everyone that's lost. You know, 47,000 people last year in America alone,
yeah.
2,000 more than the year before. For every person that passes, there's 100 people on average that are affected. You know, this, you know, you do the math, that's 4.7 million affected by suicide in one way or another just last year. So this is not something that we should be ignoring. You know, 22 of those are veterans, healthcare providers, doctors are high. Our youth from ages 14 to 25 are the second highest group of suicide. And if they're in the LGBT community, you can multiply that by three. So it's a serious, serious concern.
Yeah.
In Maryland, it's one every 13, 14 hours in Maryland alone. And, of course, I didn't know any of this until I lost my son. The average in America is one every 11.3 minutes we lose somebody to suicide in America.
So inside this interview, somebody will take their own life. And the statistics are very alarming. We talk about this on the program a lot, and I've definitely kind of gotten to know that between the suicide rate in this country, the opioid epidemic, and then our veterans coming back and not getting the help that they need. That's why we're having these conversations. And I think that your foundation, what a great start. And for you to put this together in such a short amount of time, really says a lot about the strength of your family. So in the few minutes that we have left... You're welcome. In the few minutes that we have left, I'd like to talk about some events that you have coming up in September that people can get involved with and help donate. Give us some details on those.
So we have a restaurant in Fells Point. They have graciously given us use of their restaurant once a month. Normally it's the second Thursday of the month. In August, it'll be the August 11th, and then we'll likely go back to the second Thursday. But we do a drag show there. My son was part of the LGBT community. That community suffers a lot of suicide. We're lucky to be able to focus with them and try to raise money on a monthly basis. We can sit about 140 people in there. And if your mindset is open to just having some fun and enjoying a show, I think it's a wonderful event for us every month. In September, I'm taking the Suicide Prevention Rock program. I take to high schools. I take it to colleges, to community events like HunFest. But I'm going to Delaware for the Vet Fest up in Whitehall to take that program out to the veterans that weekend. And then I just got a call yesterday, amazing call from the Quarry Theater here in Baltimore. They're actually doing a theater production about a little bit over an hour long at the end of August, and they've invited us to tell them some of our stories so they can include parts of it in the play and also have us sit on a panel after each show if we'd like to. So, again, that's the Quarry Theater. We won't raise any funds from that personally. You know, it will help get the word out and normalize the conversation. They can also find us on the Internet at www.joshuayorkfoundation.org, where folks can load up the angel or donate if they'd like to, and we're also on Facebook. If somebody wants to donate their birthday to us, we're out there. We're coming up on United Way's fall campaign. We are registered with United Way to try to get some consistent level funding so that we can plan and roll out training and other things that we're working on.
So the restaurant that you were talking about, which restaurant is that?
Point South Latin is just about the corner of Broadway and Thames.
Okay.
Turn the right on. Thames, it's right around the corner. It's like the second place in. Very, very good Latin food. Some of the best food I've ever had, to be honest with you. I love going there just for the food. Yeah, it's easy to find. They have an upstairs restaurant bar and a downstairs eating area, and we take up the whole downstairs every month.
Bill York is the father and founder of the Joshua York Legacy Foundation. I'll make sure that I get the links up on our website, 98online.com. I'll include the Kindness Rock Project. I'll also include Point South Latin, the link to that, and also the Quarry Theater. Well, please pass on my condolences to the rest of your family, and thank you so much for taking your grief and trying to save someone else's son or daughter.
Thank you, Amelia. Again, I appreciate the opportunity just to normalize the conversation.